Bless the Lord, bless the Lord, bless the Lord. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. He reigns forever. Yes, indeed. Forever and ever he reigns. Oh, glory be to God. Amen. Yes, indeed. I think that song said enough to encourage you. Amen. Amen. Said enough to encourage you. Amen. We thank God for the message that he gives us through that of song. Amen. We bless God. I was thinking this morning, just a little disclosure. I was thinking this morning, by today being the third Sunday in Advent, that the key word today is the word joy. That we rejoice today. Amen. And I thank God that you woke up with a mind. Oh, to rejoice in the Lord. The scripture writer say rejoice again. I say rejoice. Amen. All right. It is time for us this morning to observe our reading for our third Sunday morning in Advent. We're going to ask that the deaconess would come to share with us in our reading, and we will go together forward from there. You will find what you need on the screens. So when you all are ready, we are ready.
This week focuses on the Annunciation to Joseph of the birth of Jesus. When finding true joy, we have a choice. God gives us a joy that is unconquerable. We can choose to live in an attitude of resentment, anger, and fear, or we can choose to pursue the joy of Christ.
After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, and not wanting to make her a public example, that we should all be standing, was reminded or minded to put her away secretly.
But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit, and she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. We light the candle of joy.
So all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, They shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us.
Then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him, and took to him his wife, and did not know her till she had brought forth her firstborn son. And he called his name Jesus.
Amen. You may be seated as we prepare now to go to the Lord in our offering of prayer. We ask that if you have anything that you want God to do for you, it is through prayer that we make our requests known. One writer said to us that while we were yet calling, he answered. I like Paul writing that when there come times in our lives that we can't frame our sentences, because what we're facing have us so shattered and our language is somehow distorted, that it is the Holy Spirit. He receives from us and makes on our behalf a presentation unto God and say, here it is, Father, what they couldn't say, I intercede on their behalf. I'm of the faith that if you don't want God to do it, don't you tell him about it. But I just believe that if you tell him about it and start looking for him to do it, he will do it. He will do it. So we pray, O Lord, our God, our faith looks up to thee. And we are so thankful for how you listen to us and then how you respond. We thank you for being that watch eye through the night when danger unseen, unknown is lurking. We thank you for being the watch person of our lives, and that you preserve our going out and our coming in. You know our sitting down and our uprising. You know our going out, and you promise that we're blessed as we go and as we come. We thank you today for seeing our sinful need and sending your only begotten Son to rescue us from the mess that we've made, and turning our mess and misery into something miraculous. For we are amazed at what you've been able to do with these fragile lives of ours, how you have transformed our minds, and how you have, God, put our lives back together. We are thankful, and we are awed that a God that is so holy and righteous and just would have a desire to be involved in our lives and would want a relationship with us. We thank you for valuing us so much and making us the prize of your creation and desiring continuous fellowship with us. God, we thank you. We thank you for who you have been for us through the years. And we thank you for reigning in our lives, for being Lord and for being the center. We thank you. Thank you for holding us, comforting us, leading us, instructing us, being compassionate towards us, giving us mercy, sending help for us, and extending grace. As we shared on last week, favor, we thank you for it. We count it a privilege to be called your children. We count it a blessing Lord, that you haven't cast us off. And we thank you for your faithfulness unto us. We pray for the variations of our emotions today in this place, because we know that there are some who are going through things. We'll help them to understand that they're going through things. That your thoughts concerning us, that they're good and not evil. Yes, that you, O God, are with us. Indeed, we're not alone. So would you comfort those and give them peace? We pray, O God, for those that are facing things, and there are things to be faced on tomorrow. Well, you're the same God yesterday, today, and you'll be forevermore. So whatever it is that is in front of us, as long as we go with you, we know that it is well. We thank you for the doors that you have opened and closed in our lives. We thank you for your hands of provision, your hands of protection. But we also thank you for the no's, just as we do for the yeses. For we know you know what's best for us. So we pray, oh Lord, would you continually be ours and let us be yours? Would you continue, oh God, to do what you've been doing with us, growing us, grooming us, making us better day after day? So may we know today your joy and your peace that surpasses all understanding. Open our eyes, our ears, and above all our hearts to receive Christ in, that we may know you greater and that we may walk closer. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. It's okay. It's okay. Oh yeah, for the record is that I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord, and the humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name. His name together. Amen. Amen. Let us prepare now to digest our word for this morning. Amen. We want to call your attention to the reading of Luke chapter 1. And I want to read verses 20 and 21 again. Hold just a second. You got the wrong text. I got the wrong text. Matthew. Boy. What's on the screen? They on point. I'm just off. All right. Thank you for seeing that. All right. Here we are. Calm down, Gary Adams. Matthew chapter 1, verses 20 and 21. All right, we're together. I had to turn to the right book. I was over in Luke, and that story is about Elizabeth and Zacharias. So we're not there yet. We're over here. Hear the word of the Lord from the King James Version of the Bible. Excuse me. We are having children's church today, or we are or not. And they have already been excused. Have they or have they not? Good. Now I'm ready. But while he thought on these things, Behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shall call his name Jesus. For he shall save his people from their sins. I'm telling you, this is packed. I want to use for a subject this morning, discovering joy. Discovering joy. What I want to push us towards is the idea of finding joy in God's plan for our lives. I will say to you that not everything that God plans for you is comfortable. Not everything in God's plan is easy for us to accept. But the plans that God has for us will always perfect our relationship with him and grow us closer to him. I've been wrestling with the ideology for a while in my humanity that sometimes God's plans are questionable. Oh, let me shake that. Let me reshape that. Sometimes I wonder whether or not what God is wanting, if I'm clear about it. Because what I want to believe about God on this side of the spectrum, Reverend Poole, is that God won't put me in hard places. That God always is going to make sure that I'm happy all the time. On this side of the spectrum, I don't want to think about God's discipline, God's order. For as a believer, my perception of God is that he's going to heal everything. He's going to work out everything. He's going to fix everything. There's not going to be any dog days in my life. It's not going to rain in my life. That every day is going to be a perfect, smiling, laughing, hallelujah day. But in reality, I don't know what the smile means unless I've had some frowning times. I don't know what it means to have light unless I've been through some darkness. What I want us to do, and I'm trying to massage your brain to understand that when it's dark, God is working on something. When it's painful, God is working on something. When it's hard, God is working on something. When it seems like it's unbearable, God is working on something. And the subject of what God is working on is not your sickness, not your debt, not your problems, not your issues, not your boss, not your children, not your spouse, but God is working on you. God is believing that today you might struggle finding joy in your pain. But if you get through this with me, the next time it comes up, you'll say all things work together to the good of them that love the Lord. And this too shall pass. God uses our experiences to grow us, to let us know that nothing can handle us when God has ordained us. Have you ever heard somebody say
The devil thought he had me, but God reached out and grabbed me. In other words, the devil had his hands on me, but God pulled me out of the hands of the enemy. So I want you to understand that our lives are intended to have some sharp edges. I have a scar on my hand that reminds me in my childish play that there was an experience that was there. When you look at your heart and you see the bruise, it's not the pain that God wants you to remember or the bruise, but what God wants you to remember is I made it. Say this with me. It wasn't unto death. When you see that joker that you trusted, but they violated your trust. They turned things around and they use and abuse you. And when you see them again, it's not for you to be uneasy, but for you to look at that and say, even you, it wasn't unto death. How you doing, girl? I made it. How you doing, fella? I made it. So all of these things in our lives, Reverend Poole, God wants to use them to push us towards joy. Because I want you to know that things really don't change. It just on different stages. Let me ask you, how do you know what broke look like unless you've been broke? How you know what sickness look like unless you've been sick before? But see, God uses these things to say, oh, it's coming around. You're going to get sick again. But I want you to know the last time you were sick, what happened? Got healed. The last time you were broke, what happened? I took care of it. So that when stuff comes up, you'll say, God got it. He gonna fix it. Now let's get to the text. Because I want us to know that was just my brief introduction, that God is wanting us to discover joy in our life experiences, and that these things are not meant to make us frown and to have hard hearts towards God and to feel like God doesn't care. I want you to know that if God didn't care, you wouldn't be sustained. Oh, no. If God didn't care, you wouldn't be living through it. But because he cares, we're still here. I wanted to introduce you to a person by the name of Joseph. Last week, we talked about a girl by the name of Mary and how she was intrigued by an angel to say, listen, God has need of you. Gary paraphrasing. He wants you to be the carrier for his son. And won't you know that the Holy Spirit will come upon you and you shall conceive a child? And she said, how can it be when I'm a virgin? That caught me last week. And in reflection, it caught me again that she used the word that how is it that I know no man? I'm a virgin. I want you to know that God want to use the purest of things. Watch me now. Purest, not in the sense that it's sinless, but pure in the sense that it's open. Mary didn't know a man, but she was open to allow herself to receive what God wanted. The first thing I want to talk about this morning is that when we're discovering the joy of God, that we ought to find joy in knowing that God wants to use us. Here is the setup again. Joseph is engaged, contracted to Mary to become her husband. But the girl that I'm supposed to take as my wife has made an arrangement with an angel in God to be a mother of a child I ain't father. Mary didn't want to leave him blind into thinking this is yours. So she talked to Joseph about what the angel had talked to her about. I'm trying to get you to how we got to Joseph in his contemplation. And Joseph, after hearing the story, knowing that he had some friends by the name of LaJuan McGill and Derrick Poole and Dennis Black and Norwood Bill and Tommy Evans, Joseph said, what the boys gonna say about me? Because see, if she comes up pregnant, they got to know it's somebody's, and I don't want to take the blame for being an unrighteous man. Y'all ain't hear me today. Y'all ain't hear me today. Y'all ain't hear me today. Joseph is in a predicament because the arrangement is that it's God's child, but she's engaged to Joseph, and Joseph ain't supposed to touch her for about a year. And you can only carry a baby so long. So when folks start doing the math, like Danny, Gentle, and Ronnie get in that circle and say, wait a minute, 12 months, the baby's here, in 10, Joseph, we're 2 months short. What you do, boy? Did you slip? Joseph is trying to figure out how I maintain my integrity in this setup. How do I maintain my reputation in this storyline? So Joseph is sitting there at night, burning a little oil in his lap and wondering, Lord, have mercy on Jesus. What have I gotten myself into? The scriptures say that he wanted to put her away privately. In other words, Joseph was saying, I don't want to go forward with this. But what happens is this, is that Joseph, when the angel encounters him, Joseph is awakened to the fact that not only does God want to use my woman, but God wants to use his man. I'm not trying to separate y'all. I'm not trying to cause division between y'all. But I chose her because I know that as a team, y'all can make this happen. Joseph realized that even though my thinking is warped, that God still wants to use me. I'm going to tell you why that's important to me. Because see, I'm the kind of person that sits around sometimes and think about the wrong things. I'm not always holy. I'm not always righteous. I'm not always pure. I'm not always on the right track. But isn't it a glorious thing to know that when I am who I am, that my God still wants to use me, that I'm broken and I'm frail and sometimes I'm out of order. Sometimes I don't do all of the right things, but yet my God wants to use me. Sometimes I'm thinking and drinking and all other things, but after it all, he still wants to use me. There are some things I try to cover, some things I try to hide, but he knows them all. But yet he wants to use me. Oh, did I say all that out loud? Look at your neighbor. I ain't gonna tell you, but that's me too. That's me too. See, I think some things too that I'm not supposed to think. I wrestle with some things that I'm not supposed to be engaging. I got some problems that I ain't quite over with yet, but he still wants to use me. I struggle with forgiveness. I struggle with mercy. I struggle with kindness, but he still want to use me. I struggle with trying to do right by people all the time. Sometimes I get caught up in my emotion, but he still wants to use me. I've used all my curse words for this year already, and I'm over in the 22 and just about exhausted, but he still wants to use me. I'm not fully committed in giving my time, my talent, or my time, but he still wants to use me. I've gone back to the vain things I told him I'd never touch again, but he still wants to use me. still wants to use me. When I look at these hands and thinks about what they've done, oh, you still want to use me. So Joseph finds himself in a place that he's discovering that even when I'm thinking privately about a matter that really doesn't belong to me, but it belongs to God, that God heard my thoughts. That's deep right y'all. No, God heard my thoughts. Can I go ahead and clean it up and not make it too bad for you? Because I don't want you to think about that God thinking about all the bad things you think about. But I want you to think about the fact that there are some things that you're contemplating. There are some things that you're worrying about. There are some things that got you frustrated. There are some things that haven't quite come together because you're missing a nugget. God, he knows your thoughts far off. And while you're working on those things, God is getting angels set up ready to go ahead and answer when you call upon his name. They're already set. They're ready for the go command. That God understands that in your thinking, he want to turn it into a thanking.
So here it is with Joseph saying, he wants to use me in all of the things I was just thinking about Mary. He wants to use me even with all the things that she told me about his plans. He wants to use me when I've thought about that's not acceptable to me, because I was worried about what LaJuan and Dennis and Danny and Rodney and Ronnie and all of them were going to say about the kind of man I am. Joseph says to himself, forget about them. Go, speak on, Lord. Which brings me to the second point. We ought to find joy in the fact that we come to a place to know that God will perform his word. The second thing is find joy knowing that God performs his word. Now watch this thing, because this is get kind of tricky right here. Before God gives a real in-depth of his word, he talks to Joseph and he says to Joseph this, Joseph, thou son of David. Uh-oh, did you get it? You got to know who David is. David was God's chosen king, a king after God's own heart. I know y'all thinking about Bathsheba, but I'm thinking about Joseph past Bathsheba. David past Bathsheba. Uh-huh. See, all of us have had a Sheba or a Heba in our lives. See, I didn't want to say Sheba in a Heba. I want to live. Don't nudge nobody. Don't nudge nobody. Stay with me. Because this is what caught me right here, gentle. When he says, Joseph, thou son of David. See, Joseph was thinking about Joseph and Mary. But when the angel called Joseph and took him back to the son of David, he lets him know that I've been using folk in your lineage for a long time. Your granddaddy, daddy's daddy, has always been a part of my plans. Y'all ain't got it yet. 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 See, when you call the name Adams, you ought to know that it didn't start with me and God. But God knew my mother, and God knew my grandmother, and God knew my great-grandmother, and God knew some other folk before he got to me. So I'm happy to say, thank you, Jesus, that I got a history in my life that is not brand new. But I can ask my mama, what did he do when you were stuck here? And she would say, he brought me through. The last time, mama, when you were broken, you had children trying to raise them all by yourself. What did he do? He took care of us. God, when I lost my job and I didn't have nowhere to turn to, what did God do for you, mama? He made a way. It didn't just start with you. But boy, he's been doing this for our family for a very long time. Yeah.
Mama, why you think God did that? Because he promised me. He gave me his word. Let me go and get through. He says to Joseph, thou son of David. Because you got to realize that Jesus, this son, who is going to be conceived through Mary, is from the Davidic lineage. And he says to David, watch the promise. It will always be an heir on this throne. So y'all was singing a song this morning, he reigned forever. That was way back over there in Isaiah them. It would always be a king sitting on this throne. How long? Forever? How long in ever? So he gets Joseph's attention, and Joseph realizes at this particular point, wait a minute. What did you just say to me, son of David? Can I ask a question? Why do you suppose God dealt with Joseph in a dream? Quick answer, so he couldn't interrupt it. Why do you think God deal with you mostly by yourself and when your friends ain't around? No interruptions. And as soon as you wake up, what do you start trying to do? What you think? What you mean? You weren't in the meeting. It was you. It sounds kind of comical, doesn't it? But it really makes sense. Why you inviting folk to be an audience to something that they weren't a part of? They didn't hear his voice. They didn't understand everything that was said. They don't know what the arrangements were. Watch this thing. When God tells you, Sandra, you're going to be great. Pastor God spoke to me in a dream last night and told me I should be great. What you think that mean? It means you're going to be great. I can't add nothing to it, and I can't take nothing from it. Well, you see, what I'm trying to say, Pastor, is he told me I'm going to be great. And see, I got all these kind of things going on. And see, I ain't got this, I ain't got that. Do you think that God didn't know you didn't have all this and all that before he gave you that promise? Then my holy self say, well, let's think about that for us. Let's chop this up a little bit, baby. Well, he told you you're going to be great. I mean, you favored by your family. They like you, don't they? Yeah, they like your cooking, don't you? Your baking and stuff. That would be what that means. You don't just cut God down to barbecue and cakes? What about when I go on the car lot? Should I look for favor? What about when I go to work? Should I look for favor? When I go to my next doctor's visit, should I look for favor? When I walk in the bank and get ready to make some arrangement, should I look for favor? After all, he told me I was going to be great. When I have plans and begin to work my plans, shall they not come together? You talking about a strawberry cake and you talking about some chicken wings on a grill. I'm talking about when you put your hands to something, it shall be blessed. When you tread your feet upon a saw, it shall be blessed. When you open your mouth, wisdom shall flow out. You shall be great. I'm going to say something, y'all, and this is for real. This is for real. I get so tired of trying to dumb it down. Who I am, so people can be comfortable with me. You can't say what you want to say because folk are intimidated. See, I had a word that came to my mind when I said dumb it down. I wanted to use the word to mitigate. Mitigate means to reduce and to bring low. To means to change it from the greater to the lesser. I get tired of trying to find vocabulary words that I want to use but I can't use because you scared of my intellect. You feel like I think I'm better than you. No, I just got words that you might not use every day. And it's okay for us to speak different languages. It doesn't mean we are greater than each other. It just means that we are moving in the spaces that God has created for us. I got to sit in the room and put my head on rest, because if I open my mouth, profound wisdom comes out. And you're going to say, oh, you think you that smart? No, he promised me that he would give me wisdom. And when I open my mouth, so you can be comfortable, so you can be okay, I just got to rest my head. It's not me that have the problem. It's the jealousy that others have. It's the lack of understanding that my God does great things. And my God takes simple and make it big. Don't you get tired of trying to camouflage your greatness? Man, what's happening with you? You couldn't handle this. What you get ready to do next? You don't want to know. What's on your mind? I just can't tell you. I'm going to tell y'all something that's crazy. It happened a couple of weeks ago. I got into a conversation. I ain't said nothing, mind you. Pooh said it. Pooh said, when I wake up, I go to the computer, he said, I check my stock account, brokerage account, every day to see, am I a millionaire yet? And somebody said, wait a minute. What do you mean is he's a millionaire? I said, because that's what he's expecting God to do. Well, what he's doing, I don't know. I don't know what he's doing, and I don't care what he's doing. I just know that if God bless him, if I'm close enough to him and him, splashes will get on me. Y'all ain't hearing me today. I ain't got to be at all. Just as long as I get wet from what God is doing from him. I heard the Bible say, he makes my cup run over. God will bless him that it ain't room enough to contain. And when God blesses him, he'll say, Derek, I want you to bless somebody else. I'm going to tell y'all the crazy thing about it. The crazy thing about it was I couldn't even tell this person I'm looking at my brokerage account too. let me tell you why. Because if you can't handle it in that one person said it, you will lose your mind. If I told you that it's two people inside of Cathedral that's looking at any moment now for God to shift things in their lives. Did y'all hear what I said? Any moment now, that God is going to shift things. So just in the prelude of that conversation, I realized that I couldn't give no nobody content. I can't tell you what he's doing. Because if I tell you that I'm doing some of what he's doing and we talk about what we're doing, you probably get so enough twisted. Now, I was talking about the son of David. Watch this. He says to the son of David, deal with David in a dream. That was how his words right there. He deal with David in a dream. Lord have mercy. He deal with David in a dream because he realized that in a dream, David cannot interrupt. Okay. David can't put no input in it. You know why God gets you early in the morning while you ain't quite ready together? And hit you with stuff? You can't block nothing. You can't interrupt it. You can't interfere with it. God hit you with that raw data and you say, wake up and say, wait a minute, what happened? God said, I just downloaded a file. I just downloaded a file. Y'all better stay with me. Better stay with me. Better stay with me. He deals with us in the early morning. So you won't hit eject. Have you ever taken out your smart, your jump drive too soon? And it said it was improperly ejected. God hit you real quick before you can hit eject. God also deals with this because he knows that this is the calmest moment of our lives. That we're more relaxed, we're more open, and we're at a place where we're more receptive. So he deals with us in early morning hours. Can that help you understand why you awake at night and you up in the morning and you're saying, what am I awake for? Just take this script. Speak, Lord. Thy servant hears. That's all you got to say. You've been saying, why I'm awake? Maybe God is trying to tell you something. Yeah. Can I help somebody real good? Because see, if it's your children you're worried about and God wake you up in the morning, do like I used to do. Get you a little bit of oil and go in there where what you laid down with on your mind. You can't figure out nothing else why he woke you up. Just start there with oil. That this child is blessed. This child shall be great. This child shall perform according to thy word. This child shall be no problem. This child shall be what God wants him to be. And what I'm praying that, listen, y'all ain't hearing me. If you're worried about debt, put them on the table. Since you're up and lay them on the table, get a little bit of oil and lay it on the table and say, listen, this right here is going to be exhausted in Jesus' name. I declare that it's over, wiped out, it's done. If it's your spouse that you've been arguing with before you went to sleep, it's okay to put a little bit on your finger and a little bit on his or her head and say, God, I declare peace over this person's life and over, y'all ain't hearing me today. Since you're up anyway, you might as well begin to pray about the things that you've been up worrying about anyhow. If it's your job, drive early sometime. Get you some oil and go to work at your boss's office. Stop by the door knob. Put some on the door. If a door happen to be open, put some on the desk. Declare that the devil shall be defeated. And I got the victory through Christ Jesus. Chris, can I borrow one from you? Even before closing date. Can I walk in the backyard just for a little while? Can I walk around the house that I'm believing that's gonna be mine? Is it okay? Y'all ain't hearing me today. Since you're up. Since you're up, believe that God is up to something. Son of David, dealing with him in a dream, son of David, because he wanted to get David this way. I want to get Joseph this way. I want to snatch you back to the value of who you are. I got to finish because I got to move to another word next week. Hey, I want to bring you back to the reality of who you are. See, Joseph was thinking he was just a carpenter boy by trade. Failing to realize that I'm connected to somebody. When you get ready to go, put it in the application. Why are you worried? Wait a minute. You don't have no connection? When you want something that's bigger than you, why are you fretting? Don't you remember who you connected to? We so messed up, Tommy. We'd rather put down references that we know rather than we walk in the door with the confidence of who we know. We got more confidence than folk that got telephone numbers. Let me get out of this real quick. He talks to Joseph, said, Joseph, remember, you're the son of David. I need you to know that what's happening with Mary, I need you to walk alongside it, because this is of the Holy Spirit. Now, I want you to realize that not only has Mary, the Holy Spirit come upon her and she's conceived, but at the same time, the angel is birthing something in Joseph. When I saw this and looked at it again, I thought about the fact that all of us can conceive. That God can plant something in all of us. Every one of us can walk away with an egg. I know the men are talking about, well, where am I going to carry it? The Bible says that Mary pondered those things in her heart. Where are you going to put the seed? The New Testament said, I've hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against thee. So here's Joseph, not only, excuse me for this, somebody on TV going to see this. Joseph got to deal with the fact that not only is my old girl pregnant, but I got a seed too. Joseph has to accept the fact that this is what God wants to do with Mary, but not exclusive to Mary, but God wants me in on this. That's why in our marriage relationships that we got to come to the place to realize that we're not opponents. Your spouse is not your enemy. You're the team. You're the team. You said, well, how hard, this is really hard. How hard do you think it was Mary to tell Joseph this? It made him sit and say, okay, I got to get rid of this girl here. Lord have mercy, this is what she's talking about. I know God, I read about the Red Sea parting. I read about the mountain of wilderness. I read about the Jordan being crossed. I even heard about the barrels of water, man. But Mary? I mean, oh Lord have mercy. I was so in love with this girl right here. I mean, she was my everything. Man, phew, Lord. I'd rather go blind and see her just walk out on my life. I mean, oh Lord have mercy, Jesus. Oh man. Lord have mercy, Jesus. Oh Jesus. All her curves, edges, all her imperfections. Lord have mercy, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Shoot, Lord have mercy. Don't make me close one more door. I don't want to hurt anymore. Lord have mercy. Oh, Jesus. I'm just thinking out like Joseph. That's all. Wait a minute. Joseph, son of David. Oh. Remember the prophet saying that a virgin shall be with child. And when he called him the son of David, he said virgin shall be with child, because he had to tell him son of David first. And he tell him, remind him son of David. David, Joseph now connects. It's my Mary. And I'm that man that goes with Mary. What has happened, Sean, to us is that we've forgotten we're king kids. We forgot that we've been begotten by the Father through the Holy Spirit. So we go to work defeated. We walk into our marriages defeated. We're raising children defeated. We're trying to face debt defeated. We're wanting promotions and looking at defeat. We have dreams and we're talking defeat. And we've forgotten that we're king kids. Can you imagine Joseph when he connected to the prophet saying that the angel said that a virgin shall be with a child and bear a son? And he goes on to talk about his name shall be called Jesus. He shall save his people from their sin. And Joseph looks at that, I'm of the lineage of David, and that's us. Oh, man, look at God using folk that don't know how to do nothing but hammer stuff. God done changed us from hammering to happenings. He's given us something awesome to do. I want you to know today that because you are king kids, that God is calling you to greatness, and God wants to do extraordinary things with your life. I don't want you to look at what God is leading you to and how big it is, but to know that this mountain shall be mine because God has given me an inheritance and God has written my name in the book, and all I got to do is follow my script and God shall make me great. The last point, and I gotta go, is that we ought to be experiencing joy when we find out that God can trust us with big things. Watch me now. You're looking at what you see and you're saying, wow, that's big. The next question is not how big it is. You trusted me with that? I revealed it to you because I trust you with it. See, the things that's happening in your life, it's complicated. No, it's a trust issue. What God got you in, what God has allowed you to be in, you're looking at it differently. God said, I trust you with big. You saying, I can do this? Never would have showed it to you if I didn't. Never would have put it in your spirit if I didn't. I trust you with big. Listen to what he tells Joseph. Not that Mary should name him, but thou shalt name him. I trust you that when this child is born, that you're going to call him what I told you to call him, which means that if you call him what I told you to call him, that you trust that it's me that's working through you. If you do what I asked you to do, then you trust that I was the one that gave you the instruction to do it. I trust you with big. I'm trying to tell you all, stop looking at how big it is and wondering, God, can I do that? You got to realize it was God that brought you to that. So you need to change your word from can to win. Can I change it? Not God, can I do that? But when I do that. I'm encouraging you today to start looking at your stuff and start rejoicing about it. The dreams and the aspiration. Start looking at what God is saying you can be, that you are to be.
I have, wow. I'm not going to say much. I'm going to say this. But in the last 30 days, God has been me. I'm talking about, man, me. I'm talking about things that changes your position. When you look at it, you say, can't nobody be. When I was looking at this, I thought about the fact, this house, and I'm done. How many of us have hit reverse? Because what God pulled us up to, we couldn't see it as comprehensible, can be done. We looked at that big thing as a roadblock and we hit reverse. and we backed off of it rather than continue to approach it. I want y'all to listen to the text now. While Joseph was thinking on these things, God deals with our minds. And God won't put nothing in your mind that God can't deliver on. It wasn't that Joseph was bored. It was just Joseph was thinking like, okay. Because the thing with Joseph was, I want to do right. And that was the biggest struggle. You know, some folk be ugly and you're saying, I just don't want to mistreat this person because they're ugly and nasty. How should I handle this situation? My boss, Lord have mercy, I need this job, but more than my job, I need them to know that I'm a child of God. See, God will give me another job. But I don't want to lose my witness before I leave this job. Y'all ain't hear me. See, it's deeper than money. It's about movement. See, Joseph could have found another Mary. He could have found another woman, but he would have missed God's movement. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Joseph could have got another girl and some more babies, but he would have missed the movement. But I need you to understand that the stuff that you are facing at work, yeah, you can go apply for somewhere else. But what about the witness where you are? Yeah, you can curse them out. Sure, you can walk out. Sure, you can quit. Sure, you can let your hair down. Let them have it. Roll out the red carpet and walk away because you know it's your last day. But what about your witness? So here's Joseph trying to figure out, man, I got to do this right. And God gets into his thinking. Said, think about this, Joseph, son of David. You are valuable to this equation. You are valuable to this equation. Your acceptance of my will, man, bring this thing full circle. And Joseph has to answer this question. You mean to tell me you trust me with this? And God says, you bet I do. So when it comes to forgiveness, you trusted me with this? Yep. To show mercy. You trusted me with mercy? Yep. Peace in your house. You trusted me to be a peacemaker at home? Yep, you bet. Provoking my children, don't provoke them to anger? You bet. I'm trusting you. Feed the hunger. Clothe the naked. Visit them in prison. You trusted me? Yep, you my guy. Did I lose the church? God trusts you with big. He trusts you with big. Well, I'm going to just do what I did. When this text unraveled to me and I realized that God is trusting me with big, you trusted me with big? Yes, indeed. Oh, my God. His name shall be called Emmanuel, which means this is what you need to know. That when you're going towards your big, Emmanuel, being interpreted, God with us, he's with you. And when God is with you, all you have is victory. That's my time. Thank you for yours. All right. We ought to have joy. Joy, joy, joy. We ought to have joy. The Tuckaways are discovering joy when God wants to use you. God performs his word and God trusts you with big. We ought to be experiencing joys in those stations of our lives. And I want you to know today, you're not the ant or the grasshopper, you're the giant. And God wants you to just stand up and be great. Not asking you to do it by yourself, but he's asking you, come on, let's walk alongside each other and make great
things happen. You're asking, how can I? He said it to Joseph at the first statement of engagement. Be not afraid. Don't be afraid to look at what God is trying to show you and believe that with God's help, it can be done. Father, we thank you right now. We thank you for the word today. May it shake us off of our comfortable pedestals. May it create us, for us, a bed of unease. May we find ourselves restless until we pursue the plans that you have for us. Help us to set aside the opinion of others and the thought of ourselves, to know that you're bringing us to a great place, and that we can say, no longer can God, but when God. For it shall come to pass. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. God bless you. God keep you. And God gives you peace.